Howdy guys, just while we're waiting for the last couple to come in, sorry for the slightly late start. We've had some technical difficulties, and I'm going to blame my favourite Nigel Parker for that. Windows 8.1 came out 2 days ago. I'm running the latest Windows 8.1, and the Surface display drivers don't work with our system here. So all those demos have just had to be scrapped, and we're going to have to see how we go. We'll kick it off anyway. So welcome along, guys. My name is Mark Young. I work at Datacom here in Auckland. And for the next hour, I'm going to be looking at Windows 8.1 and some of the features from a development point of view and from the perspective of the experiences that we're able to develop inside Windows 8.1. See if I've got the right clicker. I've got two here and they look exactly the same. That one there's the right one. Let's go with that one. So it's 2013. And it's only seems like time's flown since a year ago. And we were standing here at TechEd at the same stage. Now, I don't need to pull out my geriatric walking stick for you to know that there's some things that have changed. 12 months ago, a Surface was a table, or maybe it was a big, huge thing with a projector on it. A helix was something that our DNA was in. A yoga was something that my wife's friends, somebody does. Now, 12 months later, we've got a Surface. We've got a Surface Pro even, and potentially a new Surface coming out. We know all about Helix, we know all about Yoga, and all these other sorts of hybrid new devices that are coming. And we've had a year playing and watching users play with Windows 8. And we've probably heard some feedback about it. Anyone been in an office? Some good, some bad, most of it loud. So 12 months later, and on October 18th this year, Windows 8.1 is going to be released on an unsuspecting public. Now, when I did these slides only a few days ago, it was going to be Windows 8.1 released on us too. But thanks to Nigel and Microsoft, we're now able to run the full RTM here. So what you'll be seeing is full RTM Windows 8. And yes, it did cause me some pain. So about 6 weeks ago, or a couple of months ago, when Steve Ballmer was at Build showing off the new Windows 8.1 preview, he was talking about it from a consumer perspective, and he related it to being a refined blend of coffee, saying there'd been like a coffee shop who had gone to create some bold new event, something big and bold, but it didn't quite work. They were listening to the customers and tweaking the bean mix and just rounding off some edges. So he's trying to say that from a consumer point of view, 8.1 was just a tweak. But what I want to show you today is that from a dev perspective, it's actually a whole lot more. From a development perspective, 8.1 is like taking your espresso or your instant coffee, sorry, and having a barista flat white. Or maybe taking your coffee and making it into an Irish sling. It's making it something much better and something quite a bit different. So my premise today is that 8.1 provides a more intuitive, more coherent, and more powerful platform for store app development. So I want to look at a few things. I want to look at the consumer experience and how it provides a more natural, integrated consumer experience. I want to show how it caters for a broader range of devices and experiences. We can build a lot more than just our single screen touch that we were building with Windows Store apps under Windows 8. And from the development experience, I want to spend the bulk of the time looking at how to a developer developing for Windows 8 is different and how it's much faster, it's more mature, and it's easier to work with. Now, just to get a feel of things, I will be talking about Windows Store development. How many of you have developed on a Windows Store application, Windows 8? Okay, only a couple. How many of you want to develop a Windows Store application? Okay, who else have we got here? We've got web devs, architects, BAs. There's got to be someone else out here. Okay, well, if you haven't developed Windows Store applications, some of the stuff won't make so much sense. Or it won't put as big a smile on your face as it does for me. If you haven't, I'm hoping that maybe you'll look to do it. But hey, I'm not going to get into that argument. I'm not going to try to fight any wars today. So I'm going to be going through what it's like from the developer. If you're wanting to look at security, some of the business pieces around Windows 8, there's other talks around that. But suffice to say, 8.1 has got much better story around the business, especially line of business applications. So let's kick off into the consumer experience. I want to show how 8.1 gives a more discoverable, better integrated consumer experience. when users first install 8.8, Windows 8, this is the screen that they get, trying to give them some hints to how to use it, because it's a bit of a step, something they haven't seen before. How many of you have seen users who actually read the manual? No, I haven't seen too many. I hear a couple of snorts out there. And so what happened, that this small step became something a little bit like this, which then resulted in pain, angst, keyboard mashing, and frequent Twitter posting saying Windows 8 is crap within the first 2 minutes after trying it. But I'm not going to blame the users for that. But what that also meant is that it impacted our applications, because our applications were tarred with the same brush. So Windows 8, from a consumer perspective, has seen this, seen that even though they made Content King, even though they did some beautiful things like getting rid of the Chrome, what it meant was that the cognitive overload for users was too high. Users didn't know where to look next. Content was king, but process wasn't. So now with some of the design guidelines, and this is not so much framework, this is the design that you're going to see in the new applications and that you should be building into your own applications. It brings process to the front as well, at least primary process. And just a couple of examples I want to call out before I show you these inside the actual applications. Design guidelines around application buttons now says that the canvas, so this is the main screen that users are looking at, is where you should place your primary action buttons. So if you've got an event that users are always going to have to do, say it's a mail application, you want to create a new email, that button should be on the screen. The user shouldn't have to hunt and peck and try to figure out where it is. In fact, they say that they should be able to complete the core scenarios just by using the canvas, so without having to guess where the app bar is. Along that with the app bar, you're going to see inside the mail application in a second that the application bar, which most of you have probably seen, swipes up from the bottom. You've got no indication that there's actually an app bar there until you try. So now there's a hint along the lines of Windows Phone. There's three dots and a little bar down the bottom just to give the user a prompt of here's something else you can do. So this is just symptomatic of this. And lastly, one of the important ones is search. Search under Windows 8 is all on the same charm on the right-hand side. So that acts as a global search, it acts as a Windows search, it acts as an application search. And users will get confused about, well, what action am I trying to do? And in an app that's all about searching, where's the search bar? So it's almost as though, I guess, the Nazis or the people who are out there who, you know, the design purists, have taken a step back and said, okay, well, based on our metrics, how about we create a system that users is intuitive for them? They don't have to do any learning. And this is going to come through your applications that I'm going to show. So here's an example of the store app. So this is the Windows store app under Windows 8 and under 8.1. Now, there are some design changes. One of the first things you can see there is that there's now a search bar that's front and center on the screen, that's on every screen. And this search provides us with a really quick way of navigating as well as finding content. And what that's done is it's freed up the primary operating system search to be able to provide a global search in a really optimized manner. It's not trying to do two things now. And so now if you type in New Zealand, now this only works if you're on a US setting, but it'll come to the New Zealand setting one day, hopefully. Type in New Zealand and you get a summary like this. You type in for a music band, you get a list of their tracks and you can click play straight away. So some of those pieces allowing the user and figuring out what the user actually wants to do. So that's a little bit of intuitive pieces. A second part where things are a lot different is around the multitasking and the interaction between applications. Previously under Windows 8, you had two options. You could multitask, but the app could only be a snap view of 320 pixels on the side and the rest. That was it. No options. And talking between apps, tough. And if you want to launch an app, well, you're gone because you've just launched the other application. So 8.1 introduces a whole bunch of new things. One, we can have much more flexible sizes on the screen. We don't have snap anymore. And we'll see this as part of responsive design. But also applications can talk and interact with each other better. They can load up another application and say, show me next to myself. Or show this one here on a different screen. Or they can talk to the contacts and the appointments that are part of the operating system. And they're able to dig and dive and talk together a lot better. So let's just see a couple of these applications. I'm going to switch back to my screen. If I can manage to use this thing here correctly. Hit the button to switch and let's go. Woohoo, we got there the first time. So here's the new start screen. First thing you'll notice is that some of the tiles are a bit bigger. Things look a bit different. And we've only got a limited set of applications here on the main screen. So I'm just going to launch up the travel application. And this is one that was also inside Windows 8. It looks very similar. But now you'll notice that search at the top. So the search is always there. It's fast. So if I type in Auckland here, if I could type, what I should see is I'm able to click on Auckland. That's coming. I'm able to navigate to it. So it's a much faster paradigm for searching and for moving around things. So there goes that application. Let's look up mail. So this has only got released a couple of days ago. And here's the new mail application. You'll notice down the bottom, we've got our app bar hints. So if that goes away, I can see the three dots. I can see that there's an application bar there. My primary actions I'm wanting to do are on the screen. And if we take a look at this multitasking, I can now move this to wider or to smaller, and the application needs to reflow as I move it. There's a few bugs in there that doesn't always completely reflow. Not only that, here's something we'll see in a little bit later on. If I flick this over to the side, the application bar down the bottom now becomes optimized for that screen size that I'm on. So applications are having to be flexible, but they're able to be, which is great. And if we look at this email, previously under Windows 8, if I click on a link to open up Internet Explorer, for instance, it would open in a whole new window, and I'd lose my context to where I am. Now when I open an app, I can tell it to go next to me, so that you can still have the context of that email while viewing this website. And then we can scan and make one smaller and one bigger as we're going around. So we'll see a little bit later how to implement this inside our own applications. But the point of this, if I can... No. The flashing. I knew I wouldn't be able to get this.
Pretty good presentation.
Yeah, if we can go back to there.
Yeah, is it there? Okay, and
background A. Ah, thank you. I'll keep this guy on. So that's a little bit. Discoverable design, enhanced search, flexible multitasking. What this means for our apps. If we create apps that are more easy to discover, if we create apps that the user can follow their primary flow, they're not going to be blaming us for what they perceive as operating system issues. They're going to love to use our app more, and therefore they're going to use it more. And we're going to see advertising revenue. We're going to see increased reviews. Any of those other pieces that might originally cause users to downgrade our app. So that's a little bit of the consumer experience. How about the devices? So Windows 8 was really only about single screen and touch. We saw before that the Windows 8 apps only operated on one screen, only on one mode. And they couldn't really talk to any devices. So this was great for a tablet. But as soon as you wanted to build a different type of experience, let's say you wanted to build maybe a member entry application, or you wanted to build something with screens or a POS application with more connectivity, you couldn't do it. Those of you who are in Lewis's talk, is Lewis here? No. Anyway, we should give him a hand. So he looked at the devices just previously. I'm not going to cover that very much. But just for those of you who have seen it, people have been down in the hub. We can do all sorts of things. We've got Lego Mindstorm, you might have seen. We've got Bluetooth capability, like these Sphero balls that I'm about to show you in a second, if it works. 3D printers, scanners, hardware. And what this means is that we're able to create a much broader set of experiences than what we could before. Here's a quick slide that I'm not going to go through, talking about some of the new APIs that are inside Windows 8.1. The yellow ones are the ones that are changed. The blue ones are new ones. And you can see here, just to call out a few, we've got a much wider range of devices, not just portable and sensors. We've got point of sale. We've got things like mag strip readers, as we'll see, USB, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi. We can send extra outputs. We've got scanners, 3D printers, diagnostics, auth, Play 2. So as we go through, you'll see that this allows us to create a much broader range of experiences than what we could before. Because Windows 8 was great from a consumer facing thing. If you want to build a kiosk system, the kiosks are made for Windows 8, but we couldn't lock it down. We couldn't do things. So just to call out a few of these new forms of input, as I've mentioned before, Bluetooth. We can talk to Bluetooth devices, USB. We can't talk to absolutely everything, but it does a pretty good job. I was trying to get an old serial port to work, and I couldn't get that one to go. But most devices are able to directly talk to USB, and you can build your own USB drivers if you like, if you've got your own device. We can build systems like POS, point of sale, because we've got barcode readers and scanners and mag strip to be able to read your credit card. You can read biometrics of someone trying to come into your office. All of these APIs come into Windows 8.1 that weren't available inside Windows 8. Just to call out another one, geofencing. This allows us to receive notifications when you move into a specific area or around a location. So we're able to build apps that are location aware, maybe that only work in Auckland, or maybe that give you specials when you're near a shop. And on this as well, we've got alternative forms of output. So we can send applications that span multiple screens. You can have a user screen and something that's display up on a projector, except for the Surface, we won't talk about that. We've got Play 2, where we can send images, we can send videos to other devices. We can send things to TVs just by clicking a couple of buttons. And for those of you trying to use the Surface Pro as your work device, yes, finally, monitors do scale for the right DPI per monitor. Woohoo. One of the interesting things I've mentioned before, kiosk mode. So you can lock it down so your application, so your device can only open up one application. It's locked down. You put that up in your front of house, or you can put that inside work. And a couple of different sorts of output. You can do text-to-speech now, 3D printing. Voice recognition is supposedly coming, but it just hasn't quite come out yet with the Bing APIs. So I'd like to demo some of this now. And I warn you that this was a demo that was supposed to be happening on the Surface, but the Surface couldn't connect up. So I really don't know what's going to happen here. So what I've got is a Sphero device. Who's seen these before? Who's had a race? Have you guys been able to have races down in the... Have we got these down in the hub to have races on? Yep, we do. Cool. So I'm going to flick this over here. I was going to have a camera on it, but so those of you in the front are going to have to see it. I'm just going to chuck it over here anyway. Am I back on to... Cool, to hit cut and I'll be back. Excellent. Cool, and I've built up the beginnings of an application. If I can flick back to my screen there. And what I've also got is one of these leap motion devices. Now this camera was supposed to be coming out of there showing forwards. I wonder if I can tilt this and you can see the ground. Yeah, let's do this. Sorry to the mic, guys. that's soft, isn't it? That's not going to work. Okay, let's throw it back. They said it was indestructible. It didn't work. Okay, so what I've got is a leap motion device. And ideally, if we can throw it inside there, I should be able to just spin my finger around, and there's a little blue light to calibrate that. And I can... Come on. Are you going to move? Yeah, oh, I've got some. Okay. I'm getting almost no movement here because of the... Okay, we're going to put that half down as a fail. Anyway, I'd like to extend this. The idea of this is that we've got a little game, got a device coming around, I've got some motion that's controlling it. Yeah, I should be able to do this over here. Let's just go up and down. Cool. And it's flashing. It's supposed to be red when it's not there, but inside these environments, these things never work. Light and lighting's no good on infrared. Okay, cool. So I want to extend this a little bit. And so I'm going to flick up Visual Studio. And the first thing I'd like to do is I'm really keen to put some text-to-speech in there. I think that'll be fun as if we're going around, every time we collide, we go, ouch, or we say something. So seeing as I haven't even looked at my cheat sheet, but that's okay. Let me just have to code this on the fly. No worries. Okay, so let's do some text-to-speech. I've got a bit of code, and I've got a method here that's going to be called every time it detects a collision. So let's just put some, maybe some text to say equals ouch. And let's create a synthesizer. So this is all directly in the API. I'm not using anything else at the moment. And we're going to assign the synth a voice. There's a whole bunch of voices that are already inside the operating system. And we can iterate them through them. We've got all voices and default voice. So we can iterate through this. This is just a list. For now, though, I'm going to pick a random one. So I think every time you say something, let's just pick a different voice. And so what we need to do with that voice is If I could type in directly. Okay. Synth. Got two easy methods. Let's see if that'll actually zoom in. Okay. Two easy methods. We can take text to stream. So this is just putting in a straight text. Or we can take this format called SSML. And SSML allows us to determine pitch and some of those pieces. So you can put intonation into your voice. But I'm not a speech therapist or an expert on that. So I'm just going to use this text one. And let's just put a word ouch in there. We go back. Make sure we're on full screen. Okay, so now we've got a stream. And what I can create is a media element. Now this is just the same media element as we show on the screen normally. I'm going to set its source to be that new stream. And I think I have to do something around the content type as well. Look at that, easy. And all I'm going to say now is play. So we've created a synth, I've set a voice, I've given it to something to say, and I'm going to hit F5 on this and see if it works. Cool, so my camera is bust. Where did my leap motion go? Let me just turn my audio on here as well so that you can see it. That would help. Cool. So let's jump back into there. And I've lost my video, but that's okay. Let me just restart that. So hopefully now, are we connected up? I can't even see it. No, it's gone to sleep. Somebody needs to give it a shake. Let me just shake that and see if it comes back alive. This is what happens when you do demos that aren't actually on the stage. And demos at the last minute, thank you to the surface. Okay, so let's just reconnect up to this puppy. Run this. And hopefully this time we should get a little red line. Cool.
Ouch.
Ouch.
I didn't pick up that collision. Let's keep going. One of these directions.
Ouch.
There we go, text to speech. Thank you. Okay. Anything else you wanted to say? Just for next time? What I'm going to do, I've got a couple of little ones. Any more strings that you want me to put in there? Come on, chuck some from the audience. Sweet as, brother. Awesome. Anything else? Okay, so next time we see this, I'm just going to take one of those random strings. And I'm going to throw a random one of those in. If I turn off my insert. Cool. So we're going to see that in a second. The second thing I wanted to build was a second screen experience. So I think this would be really good if we could have one view that the user can see and another view that's up on a big screen or something else like that. Now, I've only got one screen here, but I think we can still do it. So I just want to show how easy this is to get a second view, and because this concept of two views is actually really different. So now we can have two windows that actually operate on different UI threads and everything else. So anyone who likes frameworks with statics like Caliburn, ouch. I can see Nigel cringing on the front row there. So what we're going to do is I've already got a view, and I've actually got to edit a code, and I'm just going to copy this in because otherwise I won't get through all the fun stuff. What this method does, I'm just going to walk you through it quickly, is we've created a new view here on our main application. Inside that view, on its dispatcher, we create a new user control that I already had existing, pass in an object to it, and then here down the bottom, I can say show as standalone. And what this does is it gives me options. This is showing another window, and I've got this view size preference. So I can tell that the other window, I want it to use half, or I want it to be full screen, or less, or minimum, or more, or none. So this is this piece where I said you can create another screen, call off to another application, work with it, and you're able to coexist. So in this case, I'm going to say use minimum, because I've only got one screen, and I don't want to do it. So if I just run this, and hopefully we've got those sayings there. Ball still going? Yep. Cool, we're on there. So now you can see we've got a second screen. And this is two completely independent application windows. They can actually be closed, they can be managed by the user independently. This second screen could also go off onto a projector or somewhere else completely different. So once again, let's have a new setting.
Not again.
Duh.
Come on, let's give me some. Oh, come on, I put a keyboard shortcut in here for this and it's still not working.
Ouch.
Isn't tech ed fun?
Ouch.
Sweet as.
Ouch.
Isn't tech ed fun? You got me. You gotta be kidding.
Okay. You gotta be kidding. Let's call that the end of it. Oh, come on. You'd think I'd be able to get this a second time around. Clear layer. Swipe. I'll learn one day. Cool, so that's a little bit about devices. A little bit of fun. But the idea of this is that 8.1 now lets us talk with a lot more devices and a much broader range of experiences than we could before. We can now put this out as a gaming console. I mean, not a gaming console, but if you want something outside your office and you want to put something up that's maybe an interaction, you want to use this for interactive marketing, a whole bunch of different things that we can now do in 8.1. So now I want to kick into the dev experience. And this is from the point of view of a XAML developer. How is Windows 8.1 different? And for me, 8.1 is really the version 2 of the product. We've all used version 1 products before. We've all sworn off them. Now, Windows 8 wasn't that bad, but it was a whole new, completely different stack. And so there were things missing. There were things that weren't right. There were things that just really got up your goat and just took a lot of work to do. Didn't give you enough support. So 8.1 provides a lot more support for developers. It makes things easier, and it makes things possible to do that wasn't possible before. So I'm going to try this first by I want to show you another demo. Let's build one up, and then I'm going to go through some controls and some of the tips and tricks, features that are out there. Let's hit that one. Nope. So I've got another application. I'm just going to close down this one that we did before and turn off my sound because that could get really annoying. So here's an app that I've just built. And inside this app, if we just run her up, I've got a list of all the speakers here at TechEd that I just screen scraped off the TechEd website. So here we've got a grid. You can see those little grey boxes. If you want to find out how to fix that, come along on Friday morning. But I'd really like to build this into this new hub view with a search inside of Windows 8.1 style. So let's see how we can do this. I'm going to start off by trying to create a hub. And the idea of this is just to show you this new control that's out there that wasn't available before. So I'm going to add a new item. And under here, I should have an option for a hub. Hub page, OK. TechEd hub, let's give that a go. I've still got my template from my previous page, so I'm going to be able to copy across into my XAML most of that code. So my previous one was under the speakers piece. I'll just take the XAML here. And what I've got is I've got a data template at the top. So I'm just going to copy that directly across. There's no changes between the two. Cool, that's done. I don't think there was anything else I needed there, but just in case, let me copy that. I can't remember if that's needed or not. And I'm going to set up my application so that it boots up showing that page. Speakers, and we're going to change this here to, what was it called? TechEd Hub. TechEd Hub, okay. So I don't have anything at the moment. I haven't wired up my data context, but I should now get the default data context. So this is now the default that's built in, and it actually looks not too bad. The coding is much better than before. But we can change this, so we're going to wire this up to our own content. So let's go inside our hub view. Where am I? TechEd hub, under T. Thank you very much, down the bottom. And we've got a method here, navigationHelper.loadState. So what I'm going to do is go default view model. I'm still just going to use the built-in one. I'm going to call it, say, speakers. And I should, if I've done this right, got a repository that can give me back a list of all the speakers. So put the word await on that, chuck the async at the front. And now I've got a list of all the speakers inside a property on my default view model. So I can go down to my hub, And inside the hub, so if we just take a look at this, we've got a control now called hub. And this control consists of a series of sections, those different blocks that we saw when we were running our application. So when we're running our application here, each one of these from the hero tile, section 1, section 2, section 3, these are all separate blocks on the application that can be filled with your own content. One of the really nice parts about this is that it will only load the area as you scroll into it, so it virtualizes. Now, it won't virtualize inside an area, but it will virtualize across the thing. So it will only load each block as you do it. This was something that was really hard to do before. And the code for each one is really, really simple. We've got a header up the top for our whole hub, and inside each hub, we've got these hub sections. And a hub section can consist of any content that we like, or a background image. So I'm going to start off by doing this first hub section. I'm going to get rid of the background, and I'm going to put inside it a data template so it can host its content, and an image. Now, hopefully, if I've done this right, I've got one under assets. Let's just find what the name of that image is. Should have an image under there called assetsfiredances.jpg. So this is the image that was off the TechEd website. If we just look at the design for that, we should see that now I've got an image on the screen. So cool, really easy. And now let's show the list of speakers next to it. So here we've got our next section. We'll get rid of that grid that's there at the moment. And I'm going to throw in basically the same code that we had on our speakers list. I'm just going to put the grid view in there, exactly the same spot, and throw in a grid view, and it's bound to the name speakers. So let's run that, see what happens. Cool. So now what we've got is our first section, and then we've got our second section, which is getting truncated with a scroll bar. So that looks ugly as. Let's go back. And we can easily take off that width. Done. And we'll give it a header, and we'll call the header speakers. So if we run this, we've now got the basics of our hub view. The margins are all wrong, because we've seen it there. And we've got way too much content in there, because a hub view should really show just a short capture of data. So I'm not going to do any more on that for now, but let's just go back. And what I will do, though, is get rid of this padding, take it away, go back into the hub view, and under our list of speakers, I'm going to say... if I actually put brackets around there, so I'm awaiting it. Okay, so dot maybe order by their name, and I'm only going to take the first 20. Okay, so next time we should get only the first 20 speakers inside there. So that's how to build a hub. Really, really easy. I'm not trying to go into it. What I want to show you is that previously we had to do a whole lot of work. Previously we had to create all these pieces by ourselves. We had people like Nigel who would have to slave over pixels and margins and paddings till the cows came home. And we'll see as we go through the rest of the controls that we shouldn't have to do that anymore because the operating system's taken care of most of that for us. Or the framework has taken care of many cases of that little work around pixels and padding. Little pieces that make our dev life easier. So let's take a look at that search piece. We saw before that search is the primary way that we should be doing, it should be inside the application, sorry. So let's go back up to our header, and inside the header, I'm just going to change our hub because the default style is still not quite right. Static resource. Oh, anyone see this? IntelliSense. About time, for those of you who don't use ReSharper. And inside the grid, I'm also now going to add a search box, and I'm going to set its horizontal... how would I do this inside the grid rather than on the side? This will do. Search box. Horizontal alignment equals right. We'll give it a width of 300. And that'll do. So if we run this application out of the box... Whoops, I didn't get that one right, did I? How about I put it in the right-hand column instead of the left-hand one? This is why you should preview your things. Okay. Let's hope that one goes. So now we've got a search box here on the right. Done, that was it. If I click here, I mean, it's not doing much at the moment. No, it's not doing anything. But it's very easy to wire up. So what we need to do on that search box, got a couple of methods that are important. And suggestion requested. So let's do this one. Let's throw in a new handler for this method, which it should have created on the back end. So this is going to get called whenever the user asks us for a suggestion. So whenever they start typing. And thankfully, I've got my cheat sheet. What I'm going to do, let's code it. We've got time. So we need to grab a deferral because it's async. args.request.getDeferral. Now, can you guys see that code? Is that big enough? Or do I need to go bigger? That's OK? Cool. OK. So we're going to get our speakers again. So once again, we've got our method. Await that.getOurSpeakers. Now, ideally, you'd probably cache this behind the scenes so we don't have to do this every time. But for now, we're going to keep doing it like this. Actually, I'm not going to do that. I've already got a method up front called getSpeakerAsync. And this is a search. How about we don't do that one? I think I've got one other method. No, I don't even have the other method. Cool, I didn't even include it. No worries. We can work around that. I was going to do a really cool search, but didn't include it. GetSpeakerAsync. GetSpeakersAsync. So this is going to pull back all the list of speakers. And now what I want to do is... Actually, there's my other. I've got an overload in there. Cool. args.queryText. So that's the text the user's asked for. And how many should we take? So let's await that. Cool. I'm going to take the first 5, and I'm going to put that into a list. So there's the list of all my results. And now what I can do, if I could type, let me just move this down so you can see it. So for each speaker, we're going to build up this list. args.request, we've got a collection of results. And I'm going to append here a result suggestion. We've got query suggestions and result suggestions. These are just to show up in different ways. So first parameter text, speaker.name. Subtext, what are we going to do? Job title, what do I do? And there's a tag so we can correlate it later. And now what I can do is include an image. There's a new API that we need to do called random access stream reference. And this is a link to an image, which I can create based on my speaker's local image URI, which I've already got going. And one more alternate text, that'll do. Cool, so we've appended that suggestion. Now all I need to do is mark that as complete, and we're done. Now what have I got wrong there? I've got nothing wrong, we're good. Hit F5. So that's all I did. I grabbed our list of speakers. I've done a search through them, just going where the name's equal to something else. And now, if I type in something, I've got this really good-looking search experience. Just out of the box, hardly any code required, searches inside my application, and I can now select one of these and go directly to that person. So, yes, I typed it in. So that's our search box. So this is an experience that we couldn't do before. So I want to spend the next little bit, just while... going through some of the other controls and some of the other pieces that we can do inside 8.1 for XAML developers that we couldn't before. Again, those of you who are not XAML developers, you probably won't think it's much, but hey, this is some great stuff for some of us. Flyouts. Flyouts are little hovers that can show up when we click on buttons or similar. Or maybe it's a menu that when we click on a menu can show additional details. This is now built into the operating system, built into the platform. Really, really easy to create. Add a menu flyout option, give it some text, done. Before, this was all custom code. Similarly, settings. So settings are the panels that come in from the right-hand side like this. It's part of the UI paradigm. But previously, we had to code all this manually or use a third-party library like Callisto. Out of the box. One. And to create one, all we do is we create a settings flyout class and 2 lines to say, show it. With whatever width. We can make it dependent, which goes back to settings, or we can make it independent, that when we hide it, it goes away. So these are just examples of places where the default UI paradigm was hard to achieve before, and it's now out of the box. Input controls, there's been heaps of changes around this, and some of these look small, but for a developer, it's to enable you to build up a system really quickly that hits the UI guidelines, that you don't have to spend all your time playing with pixels and padding and margins and getting things just right. We've got this header property, set the header to a value, and that shows up above a control. That's available on text boxes, on date time pickers. Speaking of date time pickers, we've got date time pickers. Who ships a library without them? But now we've got them. So hey, that's great. Never has been so much angst about three text boxes. We can now got placeholder text. So I can name. Now these are just all pieces, again, that third-party libraries were doing, but they're out of the box now. So our date time picker we can customize. We can give it, say, what dates and what months, other things we want. So let's move on. Text display. Again, doesn't look like much. Another example of something we couldn't do before that the operating system really helps us do. Beforehand, word ellipsis, the top option, was the only way we could trim and truncate text. Now, sometimes you want something in the middle. So now we've got the character version, so cut off a character, or else it'll clip it at the end of the line. We've even got hyperlinks. Oh, I better go forwards rather than back. App bars. So you saw when I was showing the mail application before, we've got these application bars down the bottom. And these look something like this. So right-click or swipe up from the bottom or top, and you have these additional secondary commands. Previously, we had to create this off a style on a button. Now we've got a class called AppBarButton that shows up directly. We're able to create toggle ones here with checked and unchecked. And to create one, all we do is set a label and set an icon. Previously, there were some really arbitrary properties, and yet define the character text from character map and a whole bunch of other things. So this is just a really another powerful, small, easy. And as part of that, we've got a command bar now. We're a command bar before you had to build up yourself. We've now got something that obeys the UI paradigms. It's got primary commands and secondary commands. We look down the bottom, the primary commands are the ones on the right. The secondary commands are the ones down the bottom. And if we start moving this window, you'll see that the text goes away, and these become compact as we drag this bigger and smaller. All of that done by the framework for us. Previously, we had to code it. And in fact, as I go really small, the secondary commands are going to drop off. So XAML knows how to display an app bar, and so we don't have to do the work. Makes this sort of stuff so much easier than it was before. Another piece that's really, really nice is around theming. Previously, under a Windows 8 application, you got to pick light or dark for the whole jolly application. So this application is using light, which means I've got dark text on top of a light background. So if you wanted to change that for an area, like let's say you had a pop-up that had a dark background and light text, you had to retemplate every single text block and every control that was on the screen to look right. Now we're able to set the requested theme. We just look at that there. So requested theme to be dark on any area. You can see on the right-hand side here. Now all these demos are actually live, so that's cool. I've got a dark area and a light area. Just set that property, done. And even nicer, we've got this resource dictionary. Instead of using static resources, we've now got a dynamic one, which means that all the operating system themes we're able to change inside our application without having to retemplate the whole control, which we used to have to before. So I can just change just the font on this button only inside light mode with one line inside our application XAML. Couple more things. PDF support is available. We can take a PDF, we can grab an image out of that and display that on the screen. Simple, but it's something that has use cases. Now, there's no navigation controls. If you want to create a full Adobe Reader, then you're going to have to embed something else. But for displaying a PDF and a few lines for it, you can iterate through those pages, page one, page two, page three, show it on the screen. Really straightforward and simple. And media element. We've now got, if I just turn my sound on again, because this is, let's go. Okay. So media element, we have a media element. Now we've got one with controls. So we've got controls where we don't have to include anything else. We've got a full media experience. And if we want to, we can even load it from YouTube, if my network's going to work. Look at that. How many of you have seen this ad here? Okay, for those of you who haven't, this is one that came out for Windows 8, a part of Japan when Windows 8 first launched. And it's showing this whole Winners 1. So I'm just going to watch this a little bit because I like it. Okay, we get the idea. Not sure about you guys, but that's not how I play the piano. Okay, if I can just go back to my slides. Nope, I still haven't got this. I can program a computer. Thank you. Okay. Let's just wrap this up pretty quickly. So those might have been some of the controls you're looking for. There's also a whole range of fixes, and I'm just going to really skim through these. We've got things like data binding, where data binding now takes a lot of the pieces from WPF and actually works. It's also a lot faster. We've got massive performance changes, where applications will boot about 30% faster if you just retarget them for 8.1. And I'm going to be talking about that on Friday. And Studio 2013 is definitely a much improved experience. It's not perfect, and certainly this version isn't quite perfect, but it's a lot better than 2012 and some of the pieces that were there. So just finally, how do we take our apps to 8.1? What do we have to do? Well, it's really, really simple. You load up a Windows 8 application on Windows 8.1, you right-click on it and say retarget. And it's pretty much done. There are some API changes. There's a really good websites on Microsoft that will show you that. And then once you've got the bundle, you're able to submit it to the store. Now, the store's not opening until the 18th of October. But once you submit it to the store, if you've already got a Windows 8 app, you'll be able to upload your 8.1 app alongside it. And users with 8.1 will get your 8.1 version. Users with 8 will keep getting the 8 version. Or alternatively, you can upload an 8.1 version by itself. So that's pretty much me. Windows 8 brings us richer, more natural, easier experiences for our users. It makes experiences our users love, which means that they're not blaming our applications for them not being able to figure out the operating system. It allows us to build modern-style applications that cater for so many more scenarios. We can build all these additional business scenarios that we couldn't build before. And the developer experience is much, much nicer than it was before. There's lots and lots of shortcuts. So just throughout the rest of the day, some other related sessions. Some of these have already been. Some of them are later. Feel free to catch me over Twitter. My handle is KiwiDev. There's my email up there. Or if you can find me over drinks, go for it. Ryan Tarek is at the front here, is running a Windows 8 game competition. If you've probably already seen the slides, go for it. And thank you. Would appreciate any evals or anything else. So thanks a lot for coming along.